Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the MSI Beat It 2014 Global Challenge as we are in the European Qualifier doing a game at number two of Team Reno Tinkerino up against Team Empire in the winner's bracket final. The loser of this game will then drop into the lower bracket to battle up against Virtus Pro. We're getting ourselves directly inside the game right now as it looks like Cap has come back at the perfect... Cap's come back at the perfect moment. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. All right, looks like our JDL finals have reached a conclusion. And of course, this is only really just beginning, our Knight of Dota. Team Reno, Tinkerino are now going to try and play the Sing Sing Tiny, which they were doing before. And this time it's going to be in combination with EGM's Wisp. This led them to victory, in fact, during their semi-final matchup. So they can do the same thing again. Team Empire doing Earthshaker and Mirana. Didn't really have that great a game in game number one. Pulpa was kind of zoned out a little bit. But here in game number two, I think it'll be a little bit more effective. With the Mirana as well, this is mainly probably just meant for Always on a Fly. Roaming Mirana arrows, combining up with the Earthshaker. Solo gets to play up on his Earthshaker too. It's his role. That's what he likes to play. He'll be there. That means we just got cores to fill in for Team Empire. Radiant, they cancelled out the Brewmaster as well as the Centaur. Centaur would have just been way too much movement speed and chase for the Tiny to kill off whoever he wants to. And they've already got enough to deal with the Tiny as well as the Wisp that they don't want to have to deal with the Brewmaster as well. Surprisingly enough, Doombringer untouched so far here during the drafting time, as well as Razor and... as well as Viper.
Five seconds remaining.
Also probably should flag out the Faces of Void. Also not being touched. So Skywrath Mage was. He was banned out. And the Venomancer, Team Empire, have had enough of this. So they're going to have... they got the Venomancer banned out in the early stages. No more gunking up. No more Wall of Wards. Nah, that. Just straight good old-fashioned fighting with trees and Rockmen.
Team pick.
I kind of just want to see, though, a Viper pick up here from Team Empire. Normally, I'm not for that kind of stuff. Normally, I'm not a massive Viper kind of fan. But just to have the Mountain versus the Viper.
Pack.
Who gave you the order?
Team Empire's turn to pick.
Team Empire now with their third pick. Puck coming up here from Team Reno Tinkerino, which actually adds a little bit of question mark into who could be playing where. But at the same time, like, Sing Sing has a good Puck. Koif has a good puck, and even Bulba has a good puck. So, this puck could be on any lane you want it to be. It would really, though, depend on the matchup coming out from Team Empire. Remaining. Considering you're running both the Mirana as well as Earthshaker, Void! You've got yourself, puck is able to phase shift away from that attack in. So, there's an opening right there as far as, like, potentially middle lane is where I think he's going to end up. Faceless Void is also, as I said, being picked up here by Team Empire, ignored completely through the first stage of the draft. And, a man who should not be ignored anymore once he puts his ears in as well as his headset on. I'll give him audio and we can welcome a man back from the other man. Spoiler alert, if you don't want to know the results of the JDL right now, cover your ears and go la 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 la. Who won? Was it Scythe or was it Invasion?
Did you have rares bet, Toby?
Reserved.
Yes.
You bet on Scythe, didn't you?
Yes.
Yes, of course he did. Scythe took it.
Rares will run this day.
Invasion, I just want to do a like small thing because I think those of you guys who are watching didn't watch it. I know there's a lot of people who weren't watching it. Really interesting strategy. Might want to go back and look at it. Invasion tried to run a one position Warlock with a Omni Knight offlane and an Ember Spirit mid. It was interesting. I didn't really like it from the beginning, and it didn't work out. But I would love to be able to talk to Invasion, see exactly what they thought their game plan was going to be, because...
Mm. Well, we didn't understand it in game number one of that set. So.
That's true.
I'm really now a little bit weird now because we had the Viper versus the Mountain here. It's not versus the Mountain. They're on the same side. They can't fight on the same side. Like, this is not what it's like. Who gave you the order? Well, you did. We're on the same team, man. We're working together in this.
5 seconds remaining.
I mean, in some way, they were on the same side.
No, they weren't.
They were kind of on the same side. There were alliances going on, right?
Yeah, but they were never on the same side. The Mountain was part of Lannisters, and the Viper wanted to kill every single Lannister.
Yeah, but they were kind of, there was some,
especially
there was a formal
the guy
alliance. There was a formal
who
alliance
raped and murdered his children.
There was a formal alliance going on. And Oberyn just went past that and was like, let's do this.
It was his sister. There was no alliance between the two. This was not a lie.
I'm saying between the families, all right?
Between the families. The families hated each other. There was no alliance. They wanted to murder
each
other.
When it comes down to it, the North was the enemy. When you look at political factions, the North was the enemy. If Oberyn's family's tied up with anybody, it's actually with the Lannisters.
It's blasphemy.
I'm just saying, if you look at the political factions.
That is... He's
so in some way, they were on the same team.
Against the invading force of the undead. Sure. Maybe they grouped together for that one.
No, like, against Rob Stark and shit.
Oh,
I just messed with Toby's reign now.
Oh yeah.
I mean, I'm kind of serious, but
he knows.
I just like looking. He's just having a meltdown.
He knows the buttons to push. Magnus. Oh yeah, scandal. All right, now this is something which Team Empire ran, I believe, in the quarterfinals. They ran Magnus, Void. I can't remember who their last one was, however. But it was another one of those heroes that was just like a follow-up. I think they actually had the Enigma in the lineup too. But it's this RP into
Five
Chronosphere with everyone locked in and Faceless Void is empowered. So everyone's one really tight Reserve position. Time. So you're pumping off like both Empower, Cleave Damage, Maelstrom Lightning procs with Mask of Mana, Speed buff up. Not to mention you get like, you know, we always say like, oh, how long's it going to take before he's going to get his like damage dealing items up and running for a Void. So he hits the timing, so he has Chrono as well as Mask of Madness together. And stop
Five
smiling at the chat.
Remaining.
I love it when chat goes crazy.
Yes.
Spoilers. I'm sorry,
Team
but if you
Empires
haven't, if you haven't,
yeah, there's a buffer. There's a buffer for that kind of stuff, and I'm sorry, like we're past the buffer for that kind of stuff. They're shooting the next.
Snape kills Dumbledore. If you haven't gotten that one by now, you're just living under a rock
Ten
somewhere.
Seconds remaining.
I'm having a fun mood. I'm in Five a fun mood today. So it looks like Team Empire running this whole entire lineup that is like. Okay, if this happens, then this will happen, then this will happen, then this will happen, it'll be great.
Yes.
I'm afraid that Tiny Wisp is one of the best split pushers in the game. So when you don't have that 5-man RP into a 5-man Chronosphere, into Faceless Void hitting them all, and then Earthshaker jumps in and Echo Slams at the end of the Chronosphere, yada, 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 I'm kind of concerned. Like, Team Tinker have way more skirmish fighting power with both the Puck as well as the Viper. Now, the Wraith King is going to be a decent support that is able to kind of consistently fight. And the Tiny Wisp are either going to be relocating in, finding those pickoffs, or they're going to be split pushing really heavily. And Team Empire don't have the pushing power to be. Now you're laughing at it. Team Empire don't have the pushing power to really be able to take it. Right? They can't force Team Tinker back.
You're right.
Right?
You're right.
They have all this team fight, but they can't necessarily enforce the Team Tinker on their grounds 5v5.
It's at this point, though, I'm going to flag what actually happened with this lineup last time around, and with the Lich combo, it's going to get more magical. What Team Emperor actually did, in the combo I was talking about with like Magnus and Faceless Void, it remained theoretical. They won the game before they even hit the point of having all these buff-ups. Because the lineup they ran was just so lane winning that there was no way for anyone to really come back from it. So I think the first hurdle right now is like, yeah, Tiny and Wisp, fantastic split push. But the hurdle is actually surviving through the early game. That you're still going up against a Lich, so you're still meant to battle up against like having like your off lane being crippled, or potentially you try and run an off lane it will be quite for us this off lane Puck, who I love how he's not showing any of his items, putting on the courier now to travel it up there, so he's lazy bastard.
That mistake when you accidentally, well, I guess maybe it is actually legit that he wants to run out as soon as possible.
I think it's legit enough
you may be saving yourself 1 second, two, maybe two,
maybe, but it works. He's out there, he'll get the ward down. All right, where's he putting this ward?
I think he's going to wrap around, go on to the ramp area. He's giving himself the ward that also blocks out the hard camp that gives him some vision. Okay. Yeah, that makes a lot more sense. Gets it up nice and early. No one's going to suspect that they has that kind of ward. And a Puck offlane definitely does need one of those kind of wards. He's an offlane that's similar to, like, Mirana, where your escape mechanism has a pretty long cooldown. Leap is a longer cooldown than Orb, but Orb is a slower escape mechanism, you know, in that extent. And then on top of that, they're both really squishy. So you do need to have some kind of awareness of these kind of rotations. Otherwise, you're just going to get picked off over and over again. That being said, what Empire has when it comes to supports, it's not all that threatening for a Puck.
Always want to fly an AGM, get to have the run for the rune. It gets to be a race. But Always Want to Fly is going to win because he moves first. But then again, he loses because it's on the bottom lane. Bulb is going to be taking out that invisibility rune. And this is actually a wonderful rune to have up against an offlaner. But if it's great enough to have up against an offlaner like a Faceless Void, that's a different kind of question. Because Pycap, he's missed the block. Also should note too, the Pycap's the man taking up the number one role in this game. And that we've got like support EGM and we've got support Bulba.
Was Pycap playing support last game?
Because I
think with EGM making the replacement to Excalibur here, I think Pycat.
Pycat was the engine operation. I had to double check before I looked like a fool more. Hellfire Blast going to go on Mag. They're trying to bait him to get that time walk up and running. With the slow from Pycat, they can really. Yeah, there's the time walk just in case. But he'll have to already use his salve. Like, this is now 50 seconds in, he's already had to use his salve on the lane.
Yeah, look at the large amount of regen he brought to lane. He's treating this very similar to the way you treat, like, the Skywrath Mage support. Is like, just overly high amounts of regen because you know you're going to be taking so much harassment against Pycat. The Wraith King can only stun you two times.
Yeah.
He doesn't have the mana pool to be able to support that. So at that point, it's just like, okay, as long as I keep myself above half health, I'm always going to be fine. The Viper should never be able to kill me.
I love how they still haven't fixed the tree bug on Sings on the tiny.
Oh yeah, just this.
It just assumes he's walking with a tree, from the first level.
Yeah.
Wow. So Always Gonna Fly though in Scandal. So it's a fun combination for Empire to run. Scandal able to farm up with his Shockwave. He's already got the bottle coming in towards the mid, and they really control the experience. As far as Team Empire being the ones who control it, because Sing and EGM they're having to split it. But you got Sacrifice, which if he does it back far enough, Scandal as well as Always Want to Fly, get the advantage from it.
Can you check the hard camp, the really, really safe one, and the medium camp that Wisp will usually pull on the Radiant side?
Oh, on the Radiant side? Yeah,
I want to see if they actually... Yeah, they broke through their tree. So EGM is going to be doing that thing where he double stacks both of those. Mm-hmm. But right now he's spending more time in lane because of the fact that the Lich Magnus is a lot of spam. He needs to make sure the Tiny's okay before he focuses on getting the Tiny extra farm. You don't want to be stacking up camps and as a result lose your laning phase, you know?
Yeah.
So, but eventually he will start doing that. That's why he broke down the trees nice and early. And that is, and Tiny's a great hero to be able to farm those kind of stacks, right? He's got the double new combination, which is practically kills all the small and medium creeps in those camps, and then the big ones are left with very little health. And it's just easy, quick way for you to be able to farm up your Aghanim Scepter. And this is what I'm concerned because the faster treads, drums, and then Aghanim Scepter means you're even more of effective of a split pusher. You're actually going to be pushing faster than Team Empire will be able to do so.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I think that Team Tinker, I really like their draft way more than Team Empire's. But you said they pulled it off last game, right?
Yeah, so it's all through the early lane domination. At the same time, that the Tinker Wiz combo from Team Tinker was also a winning combination. So yeah. Winner versus winner, someone's going to be a loser at some point in this game. The main thing I'm actually looking to see from Team Empire is how much farm gets into this Morana and how long it takes before he gets shut down. Void's just going to keep leaping himself away on this bottom lane, but for him, it's just getting level 6. It's the damage output which you're capable of dishing out during the chrono time. And that means that Sick Scandal, even though it's nice having a Lich here, he still needs to get his early levels up. Like, he needs to get to a point where he's at level 10 and can level up in power. Goypa, that's not too healthy up there. But Sarn also needs to be right behind him with arrows, with high levels up in Starfall, and must be ready to pounce, and have just basic physical damage too. And that's why I'm liking him going into phase boost this early on. So he could try and force Koifa a little bit more out of this lane, because Koifa's kind of got the same role as the... Oh, hello, middle lane.
Oh, wow.
Sync's really, really low. Ooh. But then again, EGM, he's got enough damage. There goes your first blood in the middle lane. It doesn't get the full first blood, because it's taken by the creep wave, so you don't celebrate a creep.
Yeah, every single time I watch EGM Wisp, he always picks up the kills. He just magically seems to always get the last hits, whether it's with the spirits or everything else, but that was super, super close. That Tiny was left with just no health whatsoever. But this is obviously now a big advantage for Team Tinker because the Tiny's going to heal up real quickly thanks to the bottle pickup from EGM. That is EGM's own bottle. They didn't, like, feed the Tiny bottle away, did they?
Yeah, it's his bottle. Yeah.
He went for the bottle first, so.
Yeah, and then they haven't gone to the point of doing what, like, Fnatic used to do with their lineup back when Eero was playing with them. It's like this Eero-No-Tail combination.
Yeah, Eero would buy the bottle.
Oh, they both bought bottles. Bottles, and they never backed up. Sing Sing's coming up. He's looking for a kill right now, but he'll have to go Avalanche Toss onto Scandal with the Whisper of Balls, the Skewer, dragging Sing Sing back a long way from his home. And EGM, he's taking the aggro there, but it won't work. Frost Blast from Always on the Fly made sure that he'll be punished for his time. And again, we still don't have a hero getting a single kill in this game just yet. Everyone's getting supports only because the tower or the creep wave is getting kills. And EGM, low on life, Frost Blast already does damage. And he's actually got himself a regeneration ring.
Yeah, that was the
tragedy.
Puts
his spirits up as quick as he possibly could, but yeah, he wasted a little bit.
That was a tragedy of that skewer. The tether broke, and he was like, I have this regen, but my tether isn't up yet. I can't actually save my ally. I can regen him up the full, but I just can't get him out of that tower in time. So that was really well done by the Magnus. But. And Jonah, what level is our offlane Faces Void? Because I'm expecting him to... Okay, still level 4, so still plenty of time before he picks up his level 6.
Oh, they're coming mid lane. Bulba with a Hellfire Blast, Avalanche Toss, and goodbye, Lich. Very, very simple kill to do that kind of stuff. But yeah, Void is level 5 up against almost 6 Pycat.
Yeah, and with the Viper Strike, you may even see the Faces Void end up getting picked off somehow by underestimating the amount of damage and the amount of slow Pycat can lay into him.
Well, that's just
well. It's a maxed out time walk, actually, so he should always have enough distance to get out. But still,
Pycat still needs a little bit more levels before. Like the Viper Strike is obviously great, but he's still gonna need more points up in that poison. Not to mention the Nether Toxin for when the Void drops low.
Yeah, when they have a mech, I mean, again, if the perfect combinations happens for Empire, it's good. But otherwise, I just see the skirmish power of Team Tinker being so much stronger. They're going to be able to win these early, early engagements I see. A lot of small 2 versus 2, 3 versus 3. They'll easily be able to come out on top with just their heroes plus the early advantage that they have with mech and those sort of items. And the Tiny Wisp is just going to get bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, Empire certainly do have some late game of their own. Faces Void is very strong, especially when you pile them up with their power. But
EGM trying to be a little bit cheeky there, trying to deny the rune up to Scandal. But he'll take it and actually, did he trigger that beforehand? Because he had the bottle on him, so yeah, he must have triggered it almost instantly. Looking for an opening. If he skewers into an RP right now, okay, that'll work. Well, maybe, whoa! Avalanche will actually, all of them hits and always on a fly, but... You skewer in with no RP, and Sing Sing was able to turn into the toss, throwing Scandal back to the other side of the rock wall. Something which we don't really plan for, and I wonder if Scandal's even planning for that one as well. It's like, wait, hang on. No, so how does this affect me later on? Could I technically get tossed back to a non-RP position? And, hey, there's an RP. No skewer, however. He's going to back up before he gets killed off, and that last attack from EGM will actually kill him. The Wisp Spirits would have chased him down anyway then.
Yeah, one of those scenarios where you're like, you just throwing the RP isn't going to save you, and it's not
going to
get any
kills. Solo with the Fissure, slowing him down, but Sing Sing, he's got Avalanche of Verbal and one punch into Solo, and he'll take the kill. So Team Tinker now 4-1 on the board, and it's a 2-1-2 over now on the Tiny as far as kills, deaths, and assists go.
Yeah, this means he's going to have drums soon, so a big movement speed advantage for the duo. When you're tethered and have drums, and you activate the drums too, you guys are just flying around the map. And possibly quite literally, I'm expecting a relocate gank sometime soon. As the Wisp, okay, not quite level 6, but soon to be.
He'll reach it at some point. How's our other heroes looking in the meantime? So Silent, looks like he's also going to be building into drums. Got a Wraith Band as well as having a Bracer. So maybe we're looking at Aquila as well as drums. While Lich... Mr. Brute's first, only level 5, so he doesn't have his ulti yet, but Chrono is up. And I think it's only going to be a matter of time before Mag should be carrying a TP scroll so he can come towards that middle lane. A Chrono into a Lich ulti is going to be, like, not saving grace, but it's going to give him that space to allow Mirana to continue to farm up and slow down the Tiny. They need to slow Sing Sing's farm down, or else this will get out of control.
Yeah, same goes with the Mirana potentially teleporting to bottom lane. They could maybe get a pick off on the Viper and just rotate somebody into Mag's lane instead of the other way around. Either way is possible, whether it's shutting down the Tiny or shutting down the Viper. Either one is a viable option. The longer you draw out the mech, the maybe the less time Team Tinker are ready to fight. But obviously you also need to shut down the carry Tiny as well, so.
Koipa's pretty damn low on items, man.
Yeah, he's like, his
net worth sitting at 2.2k right now, up against a 3.5, which is in his lane, which is obviously silent. But it's like he's trying to rush a Blink Dagger instead. Mm-hmm. Which means that Puck could just evaporate at the start of a fight after he lets off a Dream Coil.
True, every Chronosphere that catches him out is probably going to result in his death.
Yep. And that's where my concern's coming in right now. Like, I remember she was even one of the qualifiers for ESL 1, was it? I remember Mousesports was playing a game when they first created, and it was Fader's Puck that was playing. And he got chronoed, and he was like a six-slotted Puck, and he just died to avoid, because he can't move, you can't do anything about it, you got to remain there and stay there. Like, Puck is all about maneuverability. Someone like Wraithkin, like, he'd love that kind of stuff. Bulba would just let his anchor trigger off and to go, hey, you've wasted all your abilities. But with Puck, you get locked and you're dead.
Yeah, they're popping the stacks now for the Tiny Whiz combination, so look for that Drums to now turn into a Point Booster, maybe even Ogre Axe.
Looks like Urn as well.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Urn for the Wisp or Urn for the Tiny?
Urn for the Wisp.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. And their kill combination, that Urn is incredibly good on this. Always.
Also, they're both going to go back to base as well, so they got to look for a moment to attack. The top tier 1 tower has to use Fortification to hold onto it, but Scandal and Mag are both waiting here for an opportunity, while Bulba is waiting in the middle lane with an Invis rune. So Orzhen of Fire is the only man there. The top tower goes down, and there was no defense, which is going to make our Team Empire a little bit skeptical about where TT are.
This is what I don't like about the lineup, is that unless Team Tinker group up, Empire, what essentially is going to happen is they're going to Chronosphere, and it's going to be a guaranteed kill. But guess what's also a guaranteed kill? This Wraith Fire Blast that's going to be hitting. And that's not a really long cooldown or a big ultimate, you know?
Oh, he started it. The relocate's coming in. There's an extra TP on the way in, and that's going to be Scandal arriving. The Moonlight Shadow trying to protect him, but Lich goes down fast enough. They're going to move down. The arrow connects on Bulba, but Sing Sing doesn't have an Avalanche Toss. Mag, though, he's got a Chrono, but the Rock Wall, there goes your relocate out. Bulba, he doesn't have his reincarnation. He'll accept the fact that he'll die anyway. Even if he had it, he shouldn't have leveled at that point. Except death. They get a one-for-one trade-off for the two supports. And
yeah,
Sing
on top
Sing's
of that,
back to farming too.
Exactly. They force rotations attack where Sing Sing is able to just go right back to farming. Meanwhile, bottom lane is going to go down.
He has no leap. Jesus. He has no mana. He's just going to destroy him, and now solo as well. Pycat shows an only Swedish supermodel, but also now able to fight. Like, man, always want to fly, dropping low. One more attack now from Pycat. He gets a double kill, and Solo's got no mana to help. He's got a totem stomp. If he's in range for a totem stomp, he's in range to die. The salve from Pycat will trigger. Mag is considering a leap into Crow, but he can't kill off this Viper.
No, they need,
well,
like,
Solo,
the arrow.
Solo, he's waited too long. The damage isn't going to be enough in time. Solo will just TP out. And goes all the way back to base as well.
I have no idea why they tried to get anywhere near that Viper. Like, he's just been free farming the bottom lane the whole entire time. This is where the Viper is the strongest. The only chance you have to kill him is like a Chronosphere into an arrow or something like that. And even then, it's going to be tough. So it's kind of useless. This is what the beauty of the Wisp Tiny combination is. Never having to go back to base. Still being able to move around the map and be a part of kills.
I think we're relocating. They're looking at Mag on bottom lane. Silence from Koi, but with the Dream Coil. They've got to get him before he actually gets out of here. Leaps into the tree line. TP scroll is available.
Toss.
To do it. And there goes your toss. Koi for into the trees. Even breaks his own path back out to safety. A very smart relocate. Now goes straight back up to top lane, where Silent is currently farming.
Is under attack.
And Bulba is very aggressively moving again. He's got reincarnation this time around, though.
Yeah. I mean, how do you outfarm a hero that never has to go back to base, that is able to be a part of kills without sacrificing farm?
You can't. They're going. Bulba's running in solo. No reaction at all. Hands off keyboard, AFK. Tosses Pycat into the mix. Totem Stomp, Echo Slam, there's your reaction. The Lich Oddy will bounce down, but EGM splitting himself up, but the Avalanche Toss will come in. The Lich Oddy's in the creep wave, bouncing back up to Sing Sing. Will you please stop letting it bounce? But Earthshaker and the Lich go down. It's the two supports, however. So you do still have the RP from Magnus, but Scandal doesn't have a Blink Dagger yet, so he can't just jump in, throw it out.
Yeah.
The Chrono must be the first initiator out here from Mag. And that means he's got to focus on killing off EGM at the start of the Chrono too.
And he doesn't have any damage because he doesn't have any
TP. TP's coming in. Leap Chrono. EGM, look at the attack speed. He's in the middle of the tether. The Starfall, however, from Sandra, the job, and Sing Sing getting RP'd in underneath the tower. Skewer as well as the Fissure. Allowed actually Magnus to get the last hit on Sing Sing, getting 415 gold and almost his 4 Blink Dagger. Arrow's still on cooldown for now, but a Starfall will kill a Bulba. Gonna save the mana, however, because there's a reincarnation. Creep Wave's coming in, so they can't get the instant hit over on the arrow.
Oh, double buyback. We're gonna relocate in.
Well, where is it? There it is, right behind it. The Earthshaker evaporates, and they go on to always want to fly. Oh, I think EGM should leave Sing Sing behind right now. Yeah, Penny will. He'll go all the way back to base and then just TP himself out, so it won't take long before he's back on the front lines.
I mean...
Oh, they saw Silent. Koifa, Silence. He's got Dreamcall available. Silent can still leap, however, then he'll dodge the Hellfire Blast, but he takes the stun from the orb. The tether up. I think it's just meant to get EGM there faster, and the orbs from EGM will take the kill.
Dude, EGM getting kills, man. That's how he does. Like, almost guaranteed kill for the puck, and all of a sudden EGM swipes it with the spirits. But yeah, that double buyback, I mean, who expects that this early on into the game?
Well, it's really cheap to do it. Why wouldn't you do it?
Pretty masterful bait. I mean, they got two quick and easy kills. It wasn't the best kills in the world. They were supports, but still definitely worth it for them. They got a tier 2 off of it.
That's probably one of those things that Sing Sing will never forget from his Cloud 9 days, because they were all about that. It was all about, like, economical trades. You know, okay, if we buy back now, how much do we lose for how much we should be able to gain? We kill off two supports. We make sure the tier 2 tower goes down as well. I'm not seeing a loss in this, because your buyback money was only what? Like, at that point, it was probably only 400 or so gold.
Yeah.
So it was very cheap to do so for both the heroes.
Yeah, if you get even just one kill, it's probably worth it.
Sink's in trouble. It's a point-blank range arrow, but then EGM comes in. He's going to relocate out to safety if they need it. And then Scandal, no RP, on cooldown for 8 more seconds. EGM will take the damage, but then Urn Charge up, and they're both back up to full life, while Pycat, always on a fly, Bale. Bail!
No!
Bail!
Oh. You gotta feel for those supports when they're just facing up against him. You're like, I'm doing the right thing. I'm teleporting away the moment I see him, and yet I still die because he's so farmed.
It's about to get his Agate Interceptor 2. I say
yeah,
about
it's gonna
to.
Get worse.
Actually, no. He hasn't.
Jeez.
That's a 16-minute Ags in for Pycat. Sol's going to go for the Fissure. A leap into Chrono. They'll need a lot more help, and the Fissure's going to keep out the rest of his teammates. Scandal has got a Blink Dagger. There does come your arrow from Sol, but
oh,
then...
Beautiful.
Oh, he got the Relocate Heroes with the Echo Slam as well, but the Avalanche Toss. Bulba's going to come in, even with that combination. Pycat hoping for a miss uphill. 23 life points. Creep Wave can't reach him in time. Pycat will get out. They got the Sentry Ward down, so they catch the Moonlight Shattered out Mirana. And you couldn't have asked for a better RP, and they call it.
Yeah.
They just call it.
I mean, that right there is the ideal scenario. You're not going to get a much better scenario against a team like Team Tinker.
It's an RP when you relocate in. Yeah.
Yeah. You managed to get a skewer onto the relocating targets. Both of them push them into the Chronosphere, results in the RP on three people because you caught the one person as well.
Uh-huh.
And that's the best you're going to get. You're not going to get your five-man Chronos. You're not going to get five-man RPs. Not up against strong teams like that. And they still got demolished just because they lost the laning phase so hard.
It was brilliant, man. It was a quick, efficient game from Team Marino Tinkerino, and now they level the series one apiece, which means we go into our third game, final deciding matchup as well. At the conclusion of our next game, we'll be doing our rare giveaway courtesy of Dota 2 Lounge. If you are a subscriber to our Twitch channel, then you will go into the running to win yourself a rare. All you gotta do is just stay inside the chat, wait to type in raffle with an exclamation mark at the front of it, and you could be taking home 5 rares tonight for just watching our live stream tonight. So, yeah, thanks for watching, everyone, and we'll be back here after this very, very short break.